and said, I know that you're horrible, but I know what kind of God I serve.
Is the word of God for us today. While he was still speaking to her, messengers arrived from the home of Jairus, the leader of the synagogue. They told him, your daughter is dead. There's no use troubling the teacher now. But Jesus overheard them and said to Jairus, don't be afraid, just have faith. Then Jesus stopped the crowd and wouldn't let anyone go with him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw much commotion and weeping and wailing. He went inside and asked, why all this commotion and weeping? The child isn't dead. She's only asleep. The crowd laughed at him, but he made them all leave, and he took the girl's father and mother and his three disciples into the room where the girl was lying, holding her hand. He said to her, Talitha kum, which means little girl, get up, or little girl, I say, arise. When the girl who was 12 years old immediately stood up and walked around, they were overwhelmed and totally amazed. And Jesus gave them strict orders not to tell anyone what had happened. And then he told them to give her something to eat. Verse 35 will be the launching platform. While he was still speaking to her, messengers arrived from the home of Jairus, the leader of the synagogue. They told him, your daughter is dead. There's no use troubling the teacher now. For the time which is ours today, as we continue this series, It Can Live Again, I want to talk from this thought, there is life after getting some bad news. Lord, speak. Your people need to hear. Your daughter is dead. That was the word that met Jairus. You can imagine it was a jolt for Jairus. It's a difficult thing to hear. His precious little girl, the one that had recently just turned 12 years of age, the one that had brought him bundles of joy, that even though this very public and prominent man who was a leader in the synagogue, this was not news that he was expecting. See, earlier in the day, Jairus knew that his daughter was sick. But now to be confronted with this turn of events, this whole idea that now what he considered to be just a sick and temporary situation now has been pronounced final. In this moment, Jairus, this prominent man, has now been greeted by some negative, some contrary, and bad news. And my brothers and sisters, in life, news comes in a plethora of ways. You and I can be honest about life, that it seems to come, and the more we seem to be plugged in and tuned in, the more negative and bad things may be. Even from a universal standpoint, as we're still enthralled in the midst of a global pandemic, even recently from the senseless tragedies that have occurred to our Asian American brothers and sisters. And yes, even within the confines of the state of Georgia, where we were told that a bill had passed that ultimately would suppress the vote of people of color. I mean, bad news seems to come all the time. But I will offer this to someone today, the wrestling of this text. It's not what happens just when you deal with it from a universal standpoint, but what happens when the bad news affects you personally. Some things that you had thought about, some things that you were still having hope in. I mean, surely, like Jairus, he thought his daughter was sick, but definitely she can't be dead. And who in this life and who is listening to me can say that has been the turn of the events? That there's some things that you had so much hope for. I mean, it was not its best, but surely not dead. Maybe it was that relationship that you had invested in, and you thought, yes, it needed some counseling and it needed some care, but now you're told it's dead. Could it be that relationship with that child that I know has been rough, but you were trying to make ends meet and you were trying to amend what had been broken, but now to hear it's dead? Maybe that opportunity, maybe that financial piece. There's many moments of life that, if we'll be honest, the news has hit us and caused us to wonder. And in our text, that's what Jairus is. He was told his daughter is dead. But to compound the matters, if you keep reading what these senseless and insensitive messengers said, they said, and because she's dead, there's no reason to trouble the teacher now. But see, when Jairus received this bad news, he was not by himself. He was walking with Jesus, and that's what complicates this text for me. See, if you go back to verse 21 of Mark 5, you'll note that Jairus humbles himself. At that time, his daughter was sick. He goes to the one that he believes can bring resuscitation to his sick situation. He goes and tells Jesus that his daughter is sick. Will you please come home with me? And so Jesus acquiesces, and Jesus starts this journey with Jairus back to the house. So when Jairus gets the news, he's not by himself. He's literally walking with Jesus. The critical thought that begins to be raised in our mind, and I will admit to you, this jarring moment of bad news gets me, because when he receives it, it comes in the midst of this evolving and maturing relationship. It comes while he's walking with Jesus. And when he first meets Jesus, his daughter was sick. But in the process of walking with Jesus, the news he gets from his house is that she's not better, she's actually worse. And I believe there's someone that's listening, that's hearing this, that's oftentimes been at that place, because you, like Jairus, when you got to Jesus, it was just a sick situation. When you got connected to Jesus, there was still a slither of hope in your mind. I mean, it's sick, but it can be turned around. Some pampering can be done. But what happens when the situation is sick when you meet Jesus and ends up dying when you're walking with him? I believe there's someone that has wrestled with that notion. You've been struggling with that. That has been a hard part. You don't want to say it out loud, but there are people who know your plight and know your journey. And they see how saved you've been. They see how you've sacrificed. They've seen how you've given yourself. And they've seen how things have not always got better. They got worse. What happens? Those of us who claim to love God, those of us who serve and sacrifice, those of us who show up and try our best and give our all, don't hurt nobody, come to Jesus with all this enthusiasm, knowing that Jesus is the one, we proclaim it, we live it, only to have it die while walking with Jesus. I'm talking to someone that's had the marriage die while you've been with Jesus. I'm talking to someone that's had the relationship be dissolved while you're walking with Jesus. I'm talking about someone who had the door closed and the window shut while you are walking with Jesus. What happens when you've got this bad news? That the worst that you thought could have happened has now happened, and here you are receiving it while you're in the company of Jesus. And my brothers and sisters, that's what really begins to put us at this crossroads that Jairus finds himself in our text. That he's received this bad news, but on the onset, on the contrary, while he's receiving the bad news from these messengers, while he's told his daughter's dead, while he's being encouraged to tell Jesus to go about your way, look at how Jesus responds. Jesus looks him in the eye and tells him, keep on believing. And I believe, my brothers and sisters, that God has given me the clarion responsibility. God has given me the prophetic unction on this morning to tell you, I know that the news has been bad, and I know that the opinions are contrary. I know that the support seems to be negative, but I come to step in the shoes of Jesus to declare to you that even in the midst of the bad news, keep on believing. Even when they told you that it could not turn around, even when they said that there was no way that hope could continue, I'm here to tell you that just what Jesus told Jairus at this fork in the road when he hears about the bad news, he's told this one thing: to just keep on believing. And that's my central thesis in this little homiletical exercise today. I need you to understand that there is life after receiving some bad news. And the reason I can declare there is life after receiving some bad news is because there's life when you keep on believing and trusting in Jesus and put your dead situation in his hands. That's what I need you to understand. I know that the naysayers say it will never be, and I know that even family members are saying that you might as well give up. Tell Jesus to go on about his business. Go and prepare yourself for the worst. But I've come to tell you what Jesus told this man Jairus in the midst of receiving this bad news: just keep on believing. Who am I talking to out there in cyber church? Holler back at the preacher in the comment section and say, preacher, I need to hear this. Just this week, I got some bad news. Just this week, I was told something wasn't going to work out. Just this week, I was given the insight that I should just go and pack my bag, start a new vision, start a new desire, start a new opportunity. But today, I come to tell you that simple command of Jesus: keep on believing. And in this moment, my brothers and sisters, Jairus decides to trust Jesus in the midst of the bad news. And because of his trusting Jesus in the midst of the bad news, here's the good news of the text, that by the end of this chapter, by the end of this story, Jairus has given his daughter back because he pressed through receiving the bad news. That's what we learn, my brothers and sisters, when we begin to trust God even in the midst of bad news. I know there is a plethora of things that are set against us, but whose report are you going to believe? And Jairus, in my opinion, gives a wonderful indication. He illustrates for you and I a life that's faithful. He shows us in this text what true faith and belief in Jesus does. It shows us that even when the going gets tough, the tough get going. It shows us that even when times are rough and the news is bad, Jesus still has the final say. So what is it that we can glean from this passage? What is it that honestly you and I can take away for many of us who are facing that tension, many of us who have that fork in the road? Jesus, according to our text, does something, but it's based upon the efforts of Jairus. What did Jairus, this ruler of the synagogue, this grieving father, what did Jairus do in this text to allow him to experience life after some bad news? First thing I want to illuminate in this passage is that Jairus teaches you and I to get to that point of receiving life after receiving bad news. He shows us, first of all, that we must commit to following Jesus all the way. The reason I say this is important and why commitment is critical is because, remember, in verse 21, he meets Jesus. His daughter's sick. In verse 35, on the way to his house, the word comes and meets them mid-journey that his daughter's dead. So quickly, he now has to make the decision. Do I stop the journey, go home alone, or do I allow Jesus to go with me all the way? And the reason he makes this declaration, even in the midst of the bad news, and even in the midst of what Jesus is saying, because Jesus says to him, keep on believing. In our greatest translation from an English standpoint, he's literally saying, fear not. He gives him this simple but yet powerful and practical phrase. He's telling Jairus, fear not. And I understand why some of us probably struggle with that, because you're saying to yourself, I received that bad news, and yet Jesus says, fear not. But understand the reason why Jairus did not quit in this journey was not just because of the words of Jesus, but because of the actions he's seen manifest while walking with Jesus. Oh, yeah, back up a few verses. The text tells us that in between the time that Jairus was introduced to Jesus and told him about his sick daughter, and the time that he now receives the bad news that his daughter's dead, a miracle has transpired. That on the way with Jairus, they happen to walk through a town, and a woman with an issue of blood for 12 long years presses her way through the crowd. Text says she touches his hem, and in that moment, what no other person could do, what no doctor could do, her issue was dried up. Jesus, in that moment, decides to turn around, faces this woman who pressed her way through the crowd, declares that she was healed by her faith because he had felt virtue come out of him. It was on the heels of this miracle that Jairus is greeted with the bad news. So when Jesus tells him, fear not, the reason why Jairus could commit to going with Jesus along the way is because of the miracle he just saw that happened in the life of the woman with the issue of blood. I need to help you here, because for many of us, we do not perceive or oftentimes appreciate what God is doing to those around us. But what if I told you that oftentimes you ought to be celebratory and putting away when you see how God moves in supernatural, miraculous ways in the life of other people? Here, I'm going to tell you that oftentimes it's just not the words that ought to grow our faith, but it ought to be the deeds that ought to grow our faith. Perhaps the reason why Jairus in this moment of receiving bad news could trust Jesus is because he had enough evidence of what Jesus can do. He had seen how he healed the woman with the issue for 12 long years, and he believed in his heart that if Jesus could do it for her, that he could surely do it for my little girl. And I need someone to recognize that in this season, you don't have time to play a hater or to rain on someone else's mirror.
miraculous parade, because I've been in this long enough to understand that when God is blessing your neighbor, that's a good place to shout, because that simply means he's in the neighborhood. That's why, my brothers and sisters, you shouldn't be ashamed to share your miracles. You shouldn't be ashamed to tell what God has done. Why? Because you never know how your testimony is going to encourage somebody else. Somebody had just had a bad day. Somebody was just given some bad news. Somebody was told that the sickness was unto death. Somebody was told that they don't have enough money to pay their bills. But when they heard your testimony about how God got you out of your sick bed, when they heard your testimony, how God put food on your table and put money in your bank, you got to understand that oftentimes God would allow some divine interruptions to oftentimes be on our journey. So when the moment comes, when our faith is tested, when we are faced with bad news, because we've seen what he has done before, it ought to strengthen us at that fork of tension in the road.
Now, I'm here to tell you, my brothers and sisters, he tells them, keep on believing. And it's interesting to note that this term, fear not, is mentioned 365 times in Scripture. In other words, God gives you and I a fear not for every single day of the year. And so he tells them, fear not. And they make the decision to allow to walk with Jesus all the way. Now, here's what's interesting. Note that Jairus and Jesus are not the only ones who go to Jairus' house. It's Peter, James, and John that tag along with Jesus. Now, remember, Jesus has his whole disciples with him. And the crowd that was around him that was there at the miracle, at the healing of the woman with the issue of blood. But when it came time to get to Jairus' house, Jairus and Jesus only bring Peter, James, and John along. There's some people, they leave on the road. And that thing began to speak to me, because it began to challenge me to understand that just because some people were there at the miracle on the road don't mean that they have the ability or the maturity to handle the journey all the way to the house. That at some point you have to be mature enough to know who to leave behind and who to take with you when you got to take Jesus where you need to have the change to be taking place. I know, my brothers and sisters, we don't want to tell people. We try to push against saying you have favorites and certain people, but I always quick to tell people Jesus had favorites. I mean, he had 12 disciples, but three were his tight boys, Peter, James, and John, because even Jesus understood everybody can't go with you all the way. And so part of my discernment in this moment is not just that I'm taking Jesus, but who's my Peter, James, and John that will have the spiritual maturity and wherewithal to handle the situation when we get to my house. See, the problem is too many of us are taking too many people from the road to the house. And Jesus understood that some people can only handle road miracles. They can't handle house miracles. And so in order for you to get the Jairus, we need to shrink the crowd a little bit, because the closer we get to where I need to operate, you can't have everybody around. Maybe it's for space requirements. We're not sure. Maybe it's restrictions. But what we do know is that this moment, based upon what he experienced with the woman being healed of her issue, and this smaller discipleship group, Jairus takes Jesus and Peter, James, and John and goes all the way to the house. I'm here to tell you, if you're going to experience life after receiving some bad news, you got to commit to following Jesus all the way. But there's something else the text also tells us, that if we're going to get this life after receiving some bad news, we have to cast all distractions out of your house. Here's what's interesting. As they get closer to the house, there's a loud commotion. You can hear people screaming and wailing in the house. Jairus' house that was housing his dead daughter, by the time Jesus, Jairus, Peter, James, and John gets in close proximity, they hear people grieving. This was not uncommon of that day. Whenever someone died or passed away, what they would do, according to the Mishnah, is they were required to have grievers or mourners. Matter of fact, their presence signified and affirmed the fact that the daughter was dead. But the interesting thing is, these mourners were paid mourners. Literally, what you had to do was pay people to come in and mourn with you. The louder they would be, the louder they yelled and wailed, once again, was setting the atmosphere of grieving. But when Jesus walks in and he confronts this commotion, notice what Jesus says. He confronts that commotion. He's really upset that they are mourning because he says, she's not dead, she's asleep. This is kind of strange. The mourners then move to mockers, and they start ridiculing Jesus. Because if she was just asleep, they wouldn't be there. Their mere presence signifies that she's dead. But when Jesus walks in the house, he says, she's not dead, she's asleep. They start to laugh at Jesus. You are crazy. Something's wrong with you. She's dead. But Jesus says, she's asleep. Now, this is important because the distinction is clear. There's a wide chasm between death and between sleep. On one hand, you have a lot of people saying, she's dead. And on the other hand, you have Jesus saying, she's asleep. Death signifies permanence. It signifies finality. But sleep means temporary. Sleep means there's still hope. And in this moment, these two contrasting forces, the mourners turned mockers, and Jesus were saying different things about the same situation. They were saying she's dead, and he was saying she's asleep. And my brothers and sisters, this thing starts to get to me because in life, you will always have those contrasts based on your situation. You'll have others who say it's dead, who say that there's no way it can ever be revived, that it's at its finality. You might as well get used to saying ashes to ashes and dust to dust. You should prepare yourself to move on. Perhaps y'all can start another family. If you're too old, maybe you can't adopt. But this here daughter, there is no way you can get her back. But at the same time, Jesus is in the competing ear of Jairus, and he's telling Jairus, she's not dead, she's asleep. In other words, you see not only these contrasting people between mourners turned mockers and Jesus, but it's also the contrast between facts and faith. And in our walk with Jesus, I want you to know you're going to always be in constant turmoil, that the facts are going to say one thing, but the question is, what does your faith say? The facts going to say that you don't have enough money in order to have the opportunity, but your faith said, my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. The facts say the disease is terminal and you got a year or so to live, but the faith says by his stripes I am healed. The facts say that everybody's turned on you and nobody wants to do anything with you, but the faith says that he'll neither leave me homeless or leave me by myself. Sometimes, my brothers and sisters, we need to understand there's a constant battle between the mourners and Jesus, our facts and our faith. But notice what Jesus does. Instead of arguing with them, he gives Jairus this one decision. Get those mourners out the house. I need you to get those disbelieving people, those mockers, those that want to stick on the fence, those that believe it's dead. This is what I need, Jairus. I need them out of the house. Now, I admit to you that I appreciate the gumption of Jesus, because Jesus doesn't go toe-to-toe with them. Jesus don't start spitting scripture to them. No, he says, if I'm going to do what I need to do, Jairus, if I'm going to be in the house, they got to be out the house. You need to make a decision, because in order for the miracle to be manifested, I need to make sure there's some excommunication of some disbelieving people done. In other words, Jairus, I need some folk out before I can do what I need to do. And I need to make the hard truth to some people, because some of y'all are staying up too late. Some of you are tense and frustrated and worried because you feel like you got to prove to other people how the Lord is going to turn it around. You got to prove to other people how there's still life in what seems to be a dead situation. You got to prove
to other people how God can turn it around. Can I help you and get you straight, boo-boo? Some people you can't argue with. Some people you don't have to explain none to. Some people you can't give them the straight of faith when all they got is facts. Sometimes the best thing you can do is give them the deuces and say bye-bye. Sometimes you just got to tell them, I know what you're saying, but in the midst of this miracle, I'm going to need you to get up out of the house because I need Jesus in the house, because only Jesus can turn my situation around. Every now and again, in order for God to add, he's got to subtract. In order for him to multiply, he got to divide. And sometimes you got to be strong enough to get some people out of the house.
I don't know what your mourners are. I don't know what distractions you have. I don't know what things are in your close proximity that could be polluting the atmosphere that's conducive, that's needed in order for the supernatural to take place. But what I'm saying is that in this season, you don't need them in the house. You don't need them all up in your business. You don't need to be returning their calls. You don't need to be going back and forth. Sometimes you got to cleanse your space in order to receive what God wants to do. That's what happened last year. Found myself needing an update to my phone. I'm a proud iPhone owner. And I appreciate how wonderful and amazing my Apple iPhone is. But I will admit to you that when they're not updated, and when a new one comes out, you can best believe your phone is going to slow down. So I was getting frustrated, having some little issues, messaging, mail, all that good stuff. But I was so relieved to hear that a new update was coming out. I didn't want a new phone. No, I wanted an update. Got ready, I set the settings at night. I put it in so while I'm sleeping, my phone would update. So when I wake up in the morning, I would pretty much have a brand new iPhone. But when I woke up, I was greeted with a warning message. And the warning message simply was that the phone couldn't update. I was frustrated, I was mad, because I refused to get a new iPhone. All I needed was the update. But somehow I was greeted with the message that it could not update. So because all the Apple stores were physically closed, I called the customer service, and I began ready to tell them how I was struggling, how I needed them to rectify my situation. Went through the whole thing, the preliminaries, and I told them my phone wouldn't update. They went through this and they went through that, until finally they asked me a critical question. What exactly is the warning on your phone? Well, as I looked at my phone, I read it, I said, well, it says it can't update because there's not enough memory. He said, oh, Mr. Goodman, I wish you would have told me that at first. I see what your problem is. I said, sir, well, tell me what the problem is. He said, understand, each update requires a certain amount of empty space. And if your phone has too much memory, too much gigabytes already in use, then your phone can't update. He said, Mr. Goodman, let me tell you, this is an easy fix. In order for your phone to get updated, you need to delete some things. There's some apps and some other stuff you need to get out, maybe some photos that need to be discarded. There's some stuff that has to be deleted before this phone can be updated. Lean in, child of God, because I feel that's going to happen in someone's spiritual life, that God is saying, I can update you, I can restore you, I can resurrect it, but some stuff you're going to have to get rid of. You're going to have to delete some apps and some delete some things. You're going to have to delete some stuff to create the space necessary for the update. And that's what the text says, is that he kicked them all out. And I need you to know there is life after receiving some bad news. First of all, you got to be committed to following Jesus all the way. You got to cast all the distractions out of your house. But there's a third and final thing this text shares with us too. If we're going to experience the life after getting bad news, you're going to have to care for what Jesus gives back to you. Text tells us that after clearing the house of the mourners, clearing the house of those who don't have faith, Jesus takes Jairus, his wife, Peter, James, and John into the room where the daughter is lying dead on the bed. I can imagine this must have been a jolt for Jairus. The last time he saw her, she was sick, but she was still alive. This would be Jairus' first time seeing his daughter dead. I can imagine that image for Jairus was seared in his mind, to see his daughter, skin pale, eyes closed, chest not moving because there is no breath going in and out. And I can imagine this was a serene space
For Jairus had now finally come to the realization that his sweet daughter is dead. But what happened next blew my mind. That while Jairus, his wife, Peter, James, or John, and then there, Mark begins to illustrate what takes place in this sacred space. Jesus walks over to the little girl, touches her hand, and then pronounces this phrase, Talitha kum. In other words, Jesus speaks to this little girl in the Aramaic. Mark is the only one that lifts up what Jesus said. And I also appreciate what he begins to add to us because he gives us the Aramaic, but he also translates what Jesus says in the Aramaic. He says, Talitha kum simply means little girl, I say arise. This had to be strange for Jairus and the mother to hear because this was a common phrase used to arouse children in the morning. Typically, when the parents were ready for the children to get out of bed, they would walk into the room and they would say, Talitha kum. They would tell the child, whether it's boy or girl, to arise. And so I can imagine for Jairus and for the wife, this had to be jarring for Jesus to use a common phrase. And perhaps they were thinking to themselves, if it was that simple, I could have done it. Maybe Jairus's wife was thinking, well, if that was all it took, I say that every morning. I could have came in and said, Talitha kum. But the thing that she didn't understand is that when she said it, nothing was going to happen. I know that when Jairus heard it, he probably thought to himself, I could have did that. I'd said that pretty much every morning. I come in the room and tell her, Talitha kum. But what Jairus didn't understand, that when he said it, nothing was going to happen. Maybe some friends in the community could have came by and said, if it took only that, we could have did that. But what they didn't understand is that they can say the same thing Jesus said and nothing could happen. What made the change is that when Jesus said, Talitha kum, what Jesus was basically saying is saying, little girl, I, Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God, am the one that's telling you to arise. And my brothers and sisters, that thing started to shock me. Because every now and again, sometimes if we're not careful, we think that as long as we speak to it, we can speak it into existence. But there's something to be said when the Lord starts speaking. And maybe the issue today is not that the Lord's speaking. The question is, are you letting him speak to your situation? Are you letting him speak to that thing which you deem to be dead? Have you allowed him to speak to that relationship? Have you allowed him to speak to that opportunity? Have you allowed him to speak to that job? Have you allowed him to speak to that parent-child relationship? I come to tell you, you can say everything you want to say, but your words ain't going to do much, and your friend's words ain't going to do much, but something happens when the Lord begins to speak. There's power in the words of the Lord, and the text says that when Jesus spoke to the little girl, she got up and started walking. I wish I had time to really push that because can you imagine the scene in that particular room? Can you imagine how Jairus' heart had to feel, how the wife had to feel, how Peter, James, and John had to be astounded? They saw what seemed to be a dead little girl, and after one word from the Lord, after Jesus telling her to get up, she don't just get up, she starts walking around. It means that the miracle of resurrection was instantaneous. It was not a gradual restoration, which is interesting because remember, she was first sick, then dead. But when Jesus spoke, which was dead became alive, which means that even though the process was gradual to bring her from sickness to death, it was instantaneous to bring her from death to life. And the only difference was it was Jesus that said it. And every now and again, my brothers and sisters, here's the good news as I get ready to close, is that the Lord says when I speak, it don't take long for things to turn around. That when I speak, it won't take long for stuff to shift. When I speak, things that once were dead, things that once were given up on, things that people thought would never be restored, that when I get in, it was dead before, but this time after I speak, it's going to be up and around walking. And I wonder who I'm preaching to in the house that can testify. That sounds about like my life, preacher, because the Lord knows I need an instantaneous miracle. I need need God to do it right now. I need a change right now. I need to be shifted right now. And that's the power of the text, that when Jesus spoke to the little girl, she got up and started walking. But that's not how the miracle concludes. The text then says that while she's walking around, Jesus looks at Jairus and his wife and says, give her something to eat. I gotta go right here now. But that thing blessed me real good, because Jesus said, I raised her from the dead. She's good as new. She's been restored. But Jairus, I need you to make sure that you feed this girl. I'm gonna give you the miracle, but what happens from henceforth is on you, because it's not just about getting the miracle, but the question is, can you maintain the miracle? And that's my final word to someone. Don't get so enthralled with the miracle. Don't get so excited over what God has done that you fail to feed the miracle, that you fail to take care of the miracle. Because if God gave it back to you, the least you ought to do is take care of it. Ought to have somebody in the comments section said, I'm going to feed my miracle. I'ma feed the restored relationship. I'ma feed the restored marriage. I'ma feed the restored opportunity. This time on my watch, I'm gonna make sure it don't die. Who am I preaching to that said, that's what I wanna do, preacher? I wanna tell the Lord, thank you for the miracle, and watch me maintain it. Goodbye, church. Happy Palm Sunday. Happy triumphant entry. But when I think of the goodness of Jesus and how good he's been, I don't just need Jairus' testimony. I got my own testimony. And somebody out there don't know he's been good, facing some bad news, facing a horrible time. But I got good news for you. We got a God that can take care of you. Have you any river that seem uncrossable? Have you any mountains that seem you can't tunnel through? But my God specializes in things seemed impossible, and he will. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? He will do what no other power can do. Anybody say, I know that power. He got power to turn it around, power to lift it up, power to strengthen you in weakness, power to get that which was dead off the bed. Shout it, shout it, shout it.
There's life after getting some bad news. Don't let what others say stop you from believing God. You'll always be facing contrary and negative opinions on the journey with Jesus. But Jesus tells Jairus, and he tells you and I, keep on believing. I know they say it's dead, but don't give up on it. I know they say it's a waste of time. Just trust me. I know they said that there is nothing that can be done. Just have faith. And that's what the text shows us, that in that moment, Jairus trusts Jesus enough to go all the way. Sometimes you got to press through the bad news. You got to press through the disbelieving people. But when you get to the house, there's some housework you're going to have to do. Some things got to be deleted to make a space for an update. Sometimes you got to get rid of the mourners and the mockers to create the right conducive atmosphere to see God do his best work. And here's the power of the text. Jesus speaks to that which others said was dead, and it came alive. Maybe the prayer in this season is, God, I need you to speak to it. That which others said would never be, speak to it. That which others have wanted me to move on from, speak to it. Not only can Jesus do it, but here's the part that gets me, but you got to feed it. Once he restored it, it's up to you to maintain it. As I get ready to pray for you on this day, I wonder how many of us are guilty of starving what God gave back to us. How many of us are guilty of walking around with a malnutritioned miracle? He brought it back, but you got to feed it. You got to maintain it. You got to care for it. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you and we bless you. And as we come to this moment, we celebrate Palm Sunday, triumphant entry. But part of our series, we're so grateful that there is life after receiving some bad news. Lord, we have been in the shoes of Jairus. We've been inundated with negative things. But God, give us the faith to press through, to still believe, to trust on the other side of bad news. We come this far to leave Jesus. So, Lord, I thank you that you love us enough to go all the way. God, I thank you that you're the one that touches and talks to that which needs to be revived. And so, Lord, I'm so grateful that when others were trying to operate based on facts, you told me to trust my faith. What they thought was dead, you said was only sleep. Lord, I pray that someone would understand that your voice, your report is the only one we should believe. And God, help us to maintain what you have blessed us with. Give us the wherewithal to make sure that we take care of what you have restored, to know that you are God that can do the impossible, because the impossible is possible with you. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. We pray. Amen. Listen, my brothers and sisters, I'm so grateful that you connected with us on today. Listen, there's multiple ways for you to partner with us. You see the ways on the screen, from text that we're joined to the number right there. Email us at connectwithus@tbcaugusta.org, or even go to our website. But to make it even easier for, right there in the comment section, just raise a hand, signify to our tab, our team, listen, I need to connect. I'm enjoying the ministry. I enjoy the word and the worship. We believe in partnership. That's a little further step than membership. You can be anywhere. I'm amazed how many people have joined us from all over the world. People have never even been to Augusta, let alone Georgia. Some don't even live in the United States. And they said, this has to be my church. And we appreciate you. We want to give you that chance. Even right now, we have an amazing team right there for our live Zoom rooms. It's a wonderful space where you can go and pray and just share. And we want to give you that chance. See the prompts right there on the bottom of the screen? We want you to connect. That's what it's about for us, partnership. Just as if we partner with Christ, Christ partners with his church. It is through partnership that we can make an impact. Listen, I look forward to sharing with you all this week. We have some incredible information about what it's going to look like for this upcoming week. Throwback Thursday for Monday, Thursday, Flashback Friday for Good Friday. And we're excited as we share in the high holy day of the year, the Resurrection Sunday. And we'll be live on Tab Global. Come check us out. We have some more times we're going to share with you this week. But if you're in our local area or within driving distance, we would absolutely love to see you in communion in the community. That is Resurrection Sunday morning at 10 o'clock at the Augusta Mall parking lot. It's going to be great. It's going to be worship. It's going to be fellowship in a safe way. And we're going to share communion. There are something for kids, so bring your children. And we look forward to seeing you. I have a special gift to give you as well, because I want you to know, being part of this partnership and connection, that we're praying with you. Listen, Tab Global, I love you, but God loves you best. We say this all the time. Because we've been blessed, we're going to be a blessing. Go in peace, and may the God of peace go with you as well.
Was that not a great word? I mean, I've heard sermons about Jairus' daughter and just please to come, like, bring her on, bringing back life, amen, even to the little girls, amen, which is so appropriate as we are ending out March, which is our women's thing, but also in the midst of Holy Week, amen, as we're thinking about life, bringing life back in this Holy Week. I am just so excited. As you can see just the energy coming out from me. I am excited about that word, and we pray it was a blessing to your spirit. We pray that this worship experience was a blessing to you. Also, be mindful of all the great things we have coming up on this Holy Week, Monday, Thursday, as well as Good Friday. Check out our social media platforms, because we're going to be putting out some content just to bless your spirit, amen, to make sure our minds are in the midst of Holy Week and what it means as Jesus is journeying through to the cross, amen, the cross, woo! And then on Sunday, amen, Sunday, we're so excited, because if you're local, amen, meet us at the mall. But if you're not, meet us back here, because we're gonna be here and we're gonna have some additional times as well. So if you don't catch the early ones, you'll catch some later ones too. So we got it all planned for you. So please make sure that you meet us back here on our social media outlets. Also, be mindful our fast is closing this Holy Week. So I hope you were able to achieve what you were supposed to achieve on this fast, saving those coins and everything. So this is the last week for the fast. So be excited. Amen. At least rejoice in that. But we are excited that you tuned in with us. We're excited that you were here. And we pray everything was a blessing. Please check us out this week, because we're here and we're loving it. And Hosanna, Hosanna, we're still loving the Lord. Peace tab.